cell phones are turned off. Because you're good that way.
Thank you, Stephen. I'm really excited and very honored to be here. And I'd like to thank Stephen and Aquila Flower, who is proud to call her alum of our department. She finished her PhD there. And the Huxley College of the Environment. So today what I'm going to be doing is talking about this latest project we have and thinking about the challenges, the cartographic challenges, the visualization challenges of representing complexities of wildlife migration. And just give you a little background. Stephen mentioned I'm the executive director of the InfoGraphics Lab. The lab started back in 1988. I was a grad student. The reason the Atlas started was to, one of the goals of it was to have capacity to do a second edition of the Atlas of Oregon, which we did. So we have a real, we have a legacy in atlas making and thematic cartography. We've done a lot of large cartography projects. We have worked naturally in a lot of GIS analysis, and we've done some web and mobile applications. We have we're actually interviewing right now, we're going to start interviewing for a new web cartography position. Supporting research, service, and instruction is really a big part of what the lab does, working with faculty members, working with agencies, and having students work in the lab has been a big part of what we do, is have students. So everything you're going to see has been touched by graduate students and undergrads. I just came back from giving a talk in National Geographic, and I have two of my former students, Riley and Lauren, are there working as cartographers. So there is a future in cartography, for those of you interested in GIS. And again, staffed by a lot of students, so I gotta get used to using this. Okay, so this project, it's really a partnership between the University of Oregon and the University of Wyoming Migration Initiative, which is a group of scientists that work. It's a joint USGS co-op within the University of Wyoming at Laramie. They approached us after they saw the Atlas of Yellowstone, which a lot of you are taking a look at, and they go, boy, we would really like to have an atlas like that to really pull together all this science, all this research, all this data that we're pulling together, studying ungulates in Wyoming, and particularly with a focus on migration. And the atlas, and one of their goals is really beginning to understand and appreciate and conserve these magnificent migrations that they're discovering there, and sharing that scientific information. So it's like perfect for a cartographer. We love to pull together information and make it available for the public. And then the Atlas specifically is to draw attention to these migrations, elevation awareness, and advance conservation and help with management efforts. And there's some concrete examples of even before the Atlas is published, which it's scheduled to be published in 2018. We'll be finishing up this next year and then sending it off to the publisher. That the map's already being used to help have an impact. This is specifically the staff. Matt Kaufman is the senior editor. He's a professor at the University of Wyoming, a wildlife ecologist, several other folks there. Emmeline Ostlin, I'm going to be talking about one of the stories that she put together. She's a writer. And then on my team, Alethea Steingesser is my main production manager, and like I said, a lot of students were involved. One of the things, this is like a great place to review a project about ungulates, is at a lodge on Jackson Lake with stuffed animals around there. It's a Wyoming, University of Wyoming Research Center in the National Park. So give you an overview of the Atlas. It pulls together information from probably about a couple of dozen or more experts and scientists. There's a core group, which you just saw, plus researchers that are working with the Wyoming Department of Fish and Wildlife, Department of Game and Fish, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, among other groups. And we're focusing, if those of you that don't know what ungulates are elk, deer, bison, moose, we're looking at bighorn sheep, and mountain goats. Focusing in on science, ecology, and conservation are the main chapters, but it is modeled after the Atlas Yellowstone, which is a much more comprehensive book. This gives you an idea of the kind of the breakdown in the book and just kind of a display of the type of pages. So it's not an atlas where we just have the state of Wyoming cookie cuttered out and you just like plunk data on it. Every page tells its own stories. And spatial extent changes, scale changes, and the data we're showing. We have, you know, we include photographs if it's necessary. We have multiple maps, sidebars, data graphics. So every story, that's why it takes a long time to build these things. What is the data we use? A lot of times with atlases, you rely really heavily on secondary data sources, things that have science that's already been done. This study in this group, we're working directly with the primary data source. Is the main data we use to tell these stories, and it's GPS collars. It's also data that's collected during the capture about the animal, thinking like their fat profile and how healthy they are. There's blood tests. Are they pregnant? And then we take that data and we process that data. And sometimes the data is feeding in live. Sometimes we get it from the callers. We download it. As a geographer and a cartographer, it's very exciting to be able to go out in the field and actually collect the primary data source. That feeling of taking this deer has not been sedated is taking the blinder off, taking the bindings on its legs off, and then letting it go and watching it spring out. It really makes you. It puts a face on the data. It's not abstract. It's very real, and it gives more meaning, I think, to the project. So this kind of gives you back to the abstract and the data. Detailed data, fine landscape scale data, spatial temporal data that we can use to really understand the character and of migration, comparing between years, between species, between individuals. So we process that data, either thinking about it in terms of the points. We can do analysis to understand the intensity of use of these corridors, and we can start to understand where stopovers are, which is a really important concept in migration. In that, potentially, like on a mule deer migration route, they might stop 95% of their time in eating, so they're foraging. They're refueling as they're following the wave of the green wave up, the phenology, a lot of times elevationally up during their spring or coming back down to on their fall migration. And with this data, we can build what we call it the anatomy of a migration, where we are able to think about not only the points and the lines and the basic geometry, but like I just said, the stopovers are identified. The winter range is identified, where they all come together in the lower elevations, or the summer range where they disperse and go to into high elevation. And then the corridors, you know, is it a high use corridor or a low use corridor? And I'll show you some examples of how those become very important in things like assessment of the corridors. I want to go through and look at five topics and the mapping and the analysis that were done in the visualization. And on one of them, I've got a short 4-minute film that I want to show you. Anyway, if there's people have some questions, you can ask. Feel free to ask if you want, or we can wait till the end. So the first story is thinking about the path of the pronghorn, which was discovered several years ago. Well, they started to discover it back in the 80s, and then they documented it in the about 5 years ago. And then Emmeline Ostlin wrote an article. She's our text writer for the Atlas, wrote an article covering 4 seasons of research that she did going out into the field and tracking where they thought that the route is and then worked with closely with photographer Joe Reese, who did this photo, in setting up trap cameras. And the idea was scientifically, and I'm going to be showing you some maps that show that they had documented it, but they wanted to get public awareness out there. And so as a journalist, both her as a writer, him as a photographer, they help get that story out there. And that's a big part of conservation, is let's get the information out there. So we're working, so how do we take this really amazing story, this phenomena and the story, and put it into an atlas page pair? So this is just a little window into the way that we start. It's it starts with first talking, but then taking those ideas, which we list in a column over there, kind of like the main things we want to show, and then we map out, sketch out on a whiteboard, how's this all going to come together on a page? This is what we call a mock-up. And any of you do any design, a lot of your GIS students, I highly recommend when you're putting together a map product, sketch it out first before you start start on the keyboard. It's really going to get your ideas down there. But anyway, you can sort of see what the main ideas was: the discovery of the path, the outreach here, and then conservation and also outreach on the other side. What are some of the things we want to put in on this map to really tell that story about the path of the pronghorn? And the path of the pronghorn, Let's see if I can get this to work here. So here's Grand Teton National Park. Yellowstone's up here. Down here is Pinedale. This is the Wind River Range. So we're looking basically kind of southwest of the Teton National Park. And the way this is the final page pair, or at least where it's at now, kind of talking about the discovery and the evolution of technology. I'll show you some zoom-ins here. Here's the documentation of the hiking the route. We call this a sidebar of the outreach. And then this is kind of pulling together really the detail of the kind of the gauntlet of a maze that these pronghorn have to navigate on their journey. So zooming in, what we see here is an evolution of technology. These are neck bands points. For old biologists, field wildlife biologists are familiar with those. So basically, they put a net back, they capture an animal down here, and then they locate it up here with binoculars. So they knew that they moved. You probably know that. Yeah, you probably use that technology. And they evolved to VHF routes, which is this is pre-GPS. We're still using these to locate callers, and then GPS. So you start to see they're filling in the information, but they're definitely, scientists have identified in 1998, they identified this route. And that was in the 2000s with the GPS callers. So, and then the documentation of the hiking path, this is the work that Emmeline and then Joe Reese did, which is kind of showing where their route is. Over 4 years they went through and to observe and photograph the pronghorn. And so what we tried to do as cartographers is sort of capture key points along there and then show the elevation. And then there's a zoom in on that. You can sort of see, this is kind of a nice evolution of spatial data of how it became much more detailed. And so you guys that are in GIS now, you're really lucky. You've got, and so are we. This is almost all the data this is the type of data we have throughout the atlas. And then their documentation. And then this, one of the things we wanted to tell was how was that process of outreach in the atlas. And then this shows all the exhibits that they did and presentations they did around Wyoming and then around the US, including Banff up in Canada. Just that outreach story. And then on the right page, one of the things we have a challenge with is that the colleagues, the biologists, the ecologists, you know, it's kind of like we want to show everything on the map. And so how do you tease out and design a map that shows so much? And that's where a lot of detailed or a lot of work goes into cartographic design to have everything so you can tell the difference between everything. You've got good visual hierarchy. And I'm going to walk you through this map and show you how much what we tried to put on here. So one of the things that you see up here, these are well pads. So that was one of the things. It's one of the things that the pronghorn have to navigate is energy development. And then we had the detailed pronghorn routes right here, which are in orange. We also wanted to show the pattern of land ownership and management, which is BLM, and then it goes in private, then into Forest Service. And we wanted to put on where the camo traps are, which are in blue. And then there's the wildlife overpasses, which they've built in there that help with migration. So kind of bringing all that together, and then have call-outs that, this is in just placeholder text right now, but basically the conservation efforts that are identified. So we wanted to tell the conservation story. So kind of pulling all that together, and then we realized that we also wanted to pull out conservation easements. That's a big part of the conservation strategy. And we really wanted to zoom in on the Kearney conservation easement, so we needed to have an inset, a blow up, and we wanted to kind of give that feel of land cover, so we used a color air photo, and then that transition into the national forest. And then another key thing we needed to show was the U.S. Forest Service protected corridor, which is a planning corridor, and I didn't show it in this talk, but we had all these design iterations to show that that's not a hard boundary on the land, it's more of a planning planning boundary. So we decided to use a hatch pattern here. So I'm kind of getting a little geeky cartography going on here, but that's, you know, how do you show all these lines and patterns and areas and textures and have it all work? And then the fences are a big problem, so I mean, not a problem, but a big challenge for migration. And so they modified fences. So that the white, which is a really great color to use for mapping, because you're not putting more ink down on the map, we wanted those to pull out and be important. So we made those white with a dashed line. And then the red ones are the ones that haven't been modified. They're still a migration problem. So we go through that whole process to be able to tell that story of again, the discovery all the way to successful conservation efforts that are going on to preserve this. And there's a zoom in on that. And you can kind of let me know if you think it works or not or communicates well. But in the end, in two pages, limited real estate, we tell a pretty big story in Wyoming, a very important one when it's concerned with migration. I kind of want to walk through another story. It's not really about conservation as much as communicating an ecological phenomena, which is the timing of the timing of moose, the Jackson herd moose, which is near the Tetons. Here's the Teton Range here, Jackson Lake. So we wanted to kind of give an overall context map, kind of a graphic here I'll show you later on timing versus elevation of their summer range. I'm not going to zoom in on these, but this is about fidelity, which means how close do they follow year after year their same migration path. And moose have really high fidelity. They go to the same summer range, follow the same route every year. We've done pages where pronghorn don't do that. They're like all over the place. And then these are a series of maps which I'll run through that have NDVI data, basically the green up or the phenology of this area through time and when moose leave and go to from their winter range to their summer range. So this is that context map, and we're on this isn't all the animals we've collared, but we highlight particular ones. These brown ones are the ones that we showed in the phenology page, and then in these primary colors we show the route in the summer range up here, and then their common winter range, kind of to give some context. And then we start out with this small multiple series in May 14th through 16th, moose 146 takes off, and she has one of the lower summer ranges here of about 8,081 feet. So she takes off, but these guys are still, they're still hanging out in their winter range. Then in between May 19th and May 22nd, moose 124 takes off, and she heads up to, now hers is a little bit lower than this one, but she has to go over to this ridge here. So that's why hers is a little bit, potentially is why hers is a little bit later. And these are trends. And then moose 178 takes off later, up at a higher range, summer range, and then towards the end of June, early July, 175 takes off up to almost 9,000 feet. And then by July and August, they're all cozy up in their summer range, and you've got we've got green up there. I mean, the whole area is snow is melted, and their summer range has feed that they can hang out at for the summer. And you see this trend. They're not all, it's not completely perfect, but that relationship, and basically that's what we're trying to show here, is that the moose that have lower wind summer range depart earlier. With higher summer range, they depart later. And we try to effectively do that in connection of why they leave earlier with the green up. So using a combination of the NDVI data and then the migration data. So that kind of that tells that story. Getting into, I think one of the more complex stories is what is the effect on all this gas well development on migration? I mean, we know it has some impact, but what is that, and how, what can we learn from the GPS data to be able to document? So this page pair is looking at the Atlantic Rim area, which is kind of down here in the south middle center of Wyoming, and this is I'm going to zoom in on this map, but this kind of shows the relationship of the gas development area and two different herds, and then we zoom in and we really look closely at the effect on three different animals, and over 2 years where gas development has happened, and then this is the speed. This looks again at how does it change their travel rates when they go through gas developed areas. And then this is on stopovers. And I'm going to focus just on part of these. So here's a zoom in, or not a zoom in, but the map itself. And you can see these are energy development areas. And these dots, the red and orange dots, are different types of gas wells. We used density analysis to take a look at intensity of use for two different herds, the green and the purple, and then their movement. And there's a detail here. Symbology-wise, we have the kernel analysis, and then we have arrows just showing the direction from their winter to their summer range. And then you can see the Dry Creek energy area, development area, is the one we're going to focus on the maps that I'll, the graphs that I'll show you down below. So we have this area where there's pretty intense usage and migration of mule deer and very intense energy development. So how does it affect, what is the effect? Well, there's two things we're looking at here. Do they detour? Do they move around when there's development? They don't all act exactly the same. The red route is 2009, and the gray route is 2008. So we see two different years, and we see development in 2008 is in gray, and development in 2009 is in black. So we see a detour effect here. And then where they do go through the developed areas, it's not like they're total barriers. It's not like fences or an interstate, but they end up speeding up. So we did an analysis when they're in each of those areas, and what we see here is a significant increase of travel time. And what does that mean? Well, what if this is a stopover area? If it's a stopover area, they're not able to stop there, or if it happens to be in their winter range. So, and they're using energy. So it does have an impact. And this is one way to really measure that impact. And at the herd level, we did the same thing. So that was for individuals. And this is a visualization showing this is the speed up through development rate. This is the rate of movement through undeveloped area. And then, you know, this would be if they go, if they speed up or if they slow down. And you see that trend that they almost always speed up. There's always faster times when they're in the developed area. And trying to show that at a herd level. Or at least at all the animals that we've collared, rather than just individuals. So it's one way for us to communicate, well, what is that impact? We know there's an impact there. And this is the kind of stuff that helps with policy decision. They really start to think about, well, intensity of use corridors, it's important to think about how do we develop, or what are our rules around developing those areas. And that kind of leads me into this, and I want to show you a 4-minute film that our group put together on the Red Desert to Hoback migration.
It's 2013, and for large mammals around North America, especially the lower 48, we typically think we kind of know what's going on. And here we have hundreds of animals migrating 150 miles across public and private lands right underneath our noses, and we didn't even know about it.
My name's Hall Sawyer, and I'm a research biologist. I've been studying mule deer in western Wyoming now for more than 15 years. We recently started a mule deer study in the Red Desert of Wyoming, and the study was intended to just document the movement and distribution patterns of what we thought was a non-migratory or resident herd in the desert. But to my surprise and everybody else's, it turns out that most of these deer migrate some 150 miles north to the mountain ranges of northwest Wyoming. This new GPS technology provides us a window into this sort of mysterious process of migration that we've never had before.
When you look at this migration on a map, you say, ooh, wow, these deer moved 150 miles. But it's especially impressive when you actually look at this migration route on the ground and see firsthand the landscape and the obstacles that these animals have to move through. 3 highways, over 100 fences, and multiple reservoir crossings, the river crossings.
My job as a photojournalist working on this project is to show people what deer migration looks like. I want to show people this type of migration footage that gets people to envision what it's like to be an animal and what it's like to be a migrating animal that's moving 100 miles, 200 miles, and try to help people think about these long distance movements. A lot of the areas that I focused on is at the outlets of these lakes called Finger Lakes. One thing that was really interesting for me is each time I'd go check the camera, I'd click through and look through the video, and there'd be a lot of vocalizations.
These migration behaviors are learned from mother to offspring, from generation to generation. Some deer use the same migration route year after year after year. What we've learned from this is that this incredible migration can take place right under our noses in the year 2012. Thousands of animals moving 150 miles. The fact that this migration can still exist in unprotected areas in this day and age is pretty amazing.
Okay, so what's our job? Our job here as cartographers is to document this. So it becomes, we take this information from this discovered important migration. We want to support the work of the ecologists and managers through their work on an assessment, which I'm passing around right now. And then we also want to take that work from the assessment and include it in the atlas. So I'm going to walk you through a page pair. The atlas, the assessment has lots of maps and it really looks in detail. But one of the things we wanted to do is have three page pairs. One is discovery of this route that Hall was talking about right here. When they first thought, oh, this is the area, this is what they're going to be studying, is just a local elevation-based migration. And what they found out was that they went the 150 miles all the way up here. And so we wanted to communicate that distance, how significant that is. And then here, put it in context with the physical landscape, combine it with some photos from their summer range and their winter range. And there's detailed maps here. So like where it's at. But then we wanted to look in detail of that landscape that Hall talked about. I mean, it's really kind of a mosaic pattern, not a mosaic pattern, but it's a very complex pattern of land ownership, land cover, and fences and roads, and special management areas. And the reason you need to communicate that is because those are like the special management areas and the land administration and the homeowners and the conservation easement managers, land trusts, you know, they're all the people that you work with to make something happen as far as and the energy development companies to make the change policy or to help have an impact to open up these corridors. So these maps, using kind of a multiple map solution, instead of putting it all in one map, we created maps of the same area. This is just one section of the corridor. First the corridor and the intense use with the physical landscape, the land ownership, and then the special management areas, and then a profile, elevation profile, and then I'll show you detail, but this is all the different land management that animal has to go through. You know, all the trespassing that it does. And then there's the context over the top. So this is the first one. This is that corridor analysis I was showing you, coming up with that, and then the intense use area along with land cover and shaded relief. And then this shows the land ownership with all the fences. So these are all the fences that they're having to navigate, those animals have to navigate. And you saw how difficult it can be if they're not wildlife friendly fences. And then this is all the special management areas, and then these are, you know, to make things even harder, they have these elk feed grounds, which are state run and are kind of unique to Wyoming, which have an impact too. So anyway, trying to communicate that in a map. What are they having to go through? And then here's the detail. And I thought this was kind of neat. We haven't seen that too often. We came up with this idea to come up with a ribbon that shows all the different land management they have to go through. And then on here, we put the different crossings, like you saw some of the water crossings and lake crossings, and then also the highway crossings. So everything's kind of laid out there for managers in the assessment and then for the general public in the atlas. And then it pulls together, you've got that whole kind of story, and then you highlight some of those challenges, like the right here, the road crossings, and then some of the fencing. So anyway, that's how we kind of like tackle as cartographers that issue. So then the last one I want to talk about is bighorn sheep in the Tetons, and that's a story of loss of migration, and or almost kind of reverse. It's not really reverse migration, but they used to go down south. They used to go down into Jackson Hole and then down on the east side for their winter range and then go up higher in the summer range. But anybody been to Jackson Hole lately? Yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of development there. So this is, you know, that's been cut off. And then they've had, there's less development on the, of course, on the west side, but then there's been also a lot of domestic sheep leasing. And so that's been a real challenge, a real stressor over the decades, centuries, for bighorn sheep. And so what we're trying to show here is that historical data here and what we know now, and then take one individual and show what do they do now, where do they go now for their migration. And what they found is that they actually go higher because the slopes are less, are windblown. So there's less deep snow higher up than there is down lower. And so that's where they hang out higher up. And how do we want to communicate that? This is the stressor showing grazing allotments. And then I'll zoom in here and showing one of the kind of more modern stressors is extreme skiers. And then a timeline here that shows sort of that history of what's going on with the Teton bighorn sheep. And so I'm going to zoom in here and look at, so this is using Natural Scene Designer. And cartographically, it's a real challenge to get the right angle on the Grand Tetons with this data. So this is their winter range in blue, spring range in green, fall range in gold, summer range in here. But this is higher than this, and that's the story we want to tell, but it's at the wrong angle. And we can't just do the classic look from the east at the Tetons that you see all over the place, because they're not cooperative because they're on the wrong side of the slope. So we played around with a lot of different angles here to communicate that, and then tried to show arrows of where they go. But to help communicate the elevation, we have a planimetric map that shows where their summer range is, or this individual summer range, and then how it goes up here to higher elevation is very clear. And then we do an elevation profile that really kind of shows where the animal is going. And then in gray here is all the herd data. That's all the data we have. So we have an individual showing where they are in summertime, and that they actually go higher in winter. So that's not their their historic migration route. And then I'm going to end on this slide just because I think it's really fascinating to think about these the stressors of extreme skiers. So we've got GPS collared animals and GPS collared skiers, and they're volunteers. And so this was a study by one of Matt Kaufman's graduate students. And then these red areas are areas that they've excluded. But this data is going to help them because the bighorn sheep are affected by this. They know they avoid being around humans, but you can start to see areas, you know, think about where they should close skiing or where they ought to think about, where animals are being impacted. But that coincidence of the skiers and the animals, and you can see how important this closure area is for the animals. You know, it's probably why they made it a winter closure area. But there's areas that aren't protected where there's skiers going. But I think that, you know, it's just a really interesting story using this new technology. But on that, I want to thank you, and I hope you found this interesting. If you have any questions, love to take some questions.